Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an investigative independent journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina and beyond. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops and Conkers newsletter. Simply type your email in and click subscribe, or you can click on no thanks. If you become a paid subscriber, you have access to scoops, exclusives, and other premium content. Today, Monday, August 19th, 2024. There was I have wrote a few stories, first about Buncombe County Sheriff's evidence room mold and safety issues that you can check out. But right now I'm going to discuss another story that I worked on all through yesterday, late yesterday, and into early this morning about historic flooding in Connecticut. Infrastructure failures and government corruption suspicions emerge. Where do the infrastructure funds go? Connecticut faces questions as critical systems falter in the wake of disaster. So please take a minute to read that story. I lived in Connecticut for years. I served on a Danbury Commission and on Connecticut DOT Advisory Committee. I freelanced for Hearst. And recently, I only heard of ctroads.org. The government officials are touting that. It did go online in 2022, years after I moved to North Carolina, but my elderly parents are still there and they experienced flooding with many neighbors in Fairfield County yesterday. Again, type your email in and click subscribe, or you can click on continue reading. I'm going to briefly share this video and some more information before go the governor is scheduled to begin a press conference shortly. Connecticut experienced some of the most severe flooding in its history yesterday, leaving communities submerged, homes destroyed, and lives uprooted. So again, please take a minute to read that thoroughly. It's just absolutely a devastating situation between the dam, possible breaches of the dam. The just amount of water was just incredible. Very historic flooding. But Connecticut is often derided as, quote, corrupticut. Suspicions of corruption are now swirling around Governor Lamont's administration. So I'll get back into that in a minute after the press conference, but let's see what Governor Ned Lamont has to say. It is now 12:48. It was scheduled to begin at 12:30. It has still not begun. So we'll see when and if it starts.
Clock yesterday, round the clock, answering any requests for state resources from municipal emergency management folks. As you well know, we are seeing many areas of need, and we continue to answer any requests that come in. That's the response side of it, if you will. We are talking about rainfall in some areas in the 1,000 year level. So we're talking anywhere from 25 year level, 100 year level, 500 year level, up to 1,000 year level. So it's really historic, unprecedented flooding. With that being said, our next step is recovery. And so we are already working with municipalities and our state agencies and our federal partners to determine whether or not we can ask for some federal assistance, whether it's federal highway assistance, FEMA assistance, or even the SBA. So that's a very, very preliminary stage because we are still working to do the response part of things, but we are working through that very diligently, and we'll have more to follow on that as well. With that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Colonel Lockman of the Connecticut State Police.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Colonel Daniel Lockman, Commanding Officer of State Police, and I'd like to provide an update with the flooding that occurred within the state, specifically the town under Connecticut State Police jurisdiction that received the most impact, which was Oxford. The rainfall caused significant flooding and has resulted in both loss of life, damage to property, and has impacted the towns with a substantial number of road closures. Last night, the Connecticut State Police assisted with assets and personnel in rescue efforts to extract those who were stranded in Cowtown State Park, as well as Jackson Cove on Lake Zurb. The only access to rescue was by boat. The efforts were successful and they were evacuated to a shelter in Southbury. Yesterday, it was reported that two women were swept away by floodwaters in the town of Oxford. Two individuals have been located today, and it's believed that the recoveries were the individuals witnessed and reportedly swept away by floodwaters. At this difficult time, our thoughts are with the family of the deceased. I want to assure you that the state police remains on scene, as this remains an active and ongoing incident. Our canine search and rescue teams and a drone team are staged in the town of Oxford, and we are ready to help with the search and recovery efforts. Our aviation unit believes that there's a window this afternoon that they'll be able to get up in the air, and they will also be assisting. Oxford PD is operationally closed due to flooding. The building was successfully evacuated yesterday with no known injuries. Operations for Oxford PD have shifted to Troop A in Southbury. Any routine calls should be directed to Troop A at 203-267-2200. All emergency calls will still go to 911. Again, all emergency calls 911. State police urge all motorists to check road conditions before driving to their destinations. Motorists should not drive over water or that are closed due to water. Turn around and do not drown. I ask that everyone avoid the area if at all possible. And I'd like to thank our brother and sister partners at Dennis, the local fire departments, local and municipal police departments, DOT, and utility companies, among others. Any additional information will be released at cspnews.org. Thank you, and that's all the information I can share at this time. I'd like to introduce the Commissioner of the Department of Emergency Services and Public Protection, Commissioner Ronnell Haynes.
Thank you, Colonel. Good afternoon, everyone. As you've heard from both our State Emergency Management and Colonel Lockman of the Connecticut State Police, we have been and continue to work around the clock to make sure that resources are deployed. We are in constant communication with all of our partners at the local, state, and federal level. As you heard Deputy Commissioner Bergeron share, we are working with them closely on going from response to recovery. We know that working together is crucial, and that's what we do in this state. We work together with our partners all over the state on both on all this on this on the local, the state, and the federal levels. I want to say I'm grateful for the partnerships of our emergency management teams. John Field, who's been doing an amazing job fielding calls around the clock. They have slept very little, very little. I also want to give a shout out to our first responders who supported those community members in the town of Oxford over the last 24 hours in their time of need. I just want to say that we will continue to work with all of our partners, as I said before, and as you've heard, on the federal, the state, and the local level to make sure that we have a well-thought-out recovery stage. At this point in time, I'm going to bring up our Senator Blumenthal for remarks. I'm sorry. Was it Commissioner Iglio? Commissioner. Okay, sorry.
My name is Gary Iglio. I'm the Commissioner of the Connecticut Department of Transportation. Just a quick update from our side. So, just on the state road side, as of this moment, we have 27 reported closures of state roadways. That number may increase or decrease at any moment. So, I encourage the public to check ctroads.org. That is where we constantly are updating the status of our state roadways. That does not include local roadways that may also be closed. I do want to thank our partner first responders as well as our partner local DPWs have been working all night to try and secure our infrastructure. A few important points is if there are cones or barrels or caution tape up, I strongly am encouraging everyone to adhere to those signs. Do not cross those roadways. You don't necessarily know what is underneath the pavement. The pavement could have been undermined. The bridges could have been impacted by scouring. That caution tape and those barrels are up for a reason. The other important point is that, there may be future closures that we identify as we are spending today inspecting everything. We've had several hundred crews out there looking at all of our infrastructure, inspecting above and below the surface of the roadway and the bridges to see what we may or may not be able to find. As water continues to move down our water courses, debris is in the waterways that may clog our culverts and bridges. So that may also end up impacting more infrastructure. We're hopeful that is not the case, but just because today you may have passed over it, tomorrow it may end up being closed. So pay attention to those barrels and cones and caution tape. The other important thing is it's going to be a long recovery. I know I'm going to be asked when we're going to open certain roads. And honestly saying we don't know. We need to fully inspect every single bridge that has been impacted and the pavement that has been impacted. And until we do that inspection, until we talk to our contractors, we do not know when those bridges or roadways will be reopened. So I'm asking for everyone's patience, and please be safe and avoid passing through those areas. Thank you.
Good morning. Katie Dykes here, Commissioner of the Connecticut Department of Energy and Environmental Protection. I want to provide an update on a few of the different operational impacts associated with DEEP's programs. First and foremost, yesterday, I can share with our Bureau of Outdoor Recreation that we worked very closely with first responders to help evacuate nearly 50 campers who were stranded at the Kettletown campground. When a bridge that is the only access point for that campground was washed away. So all of the campers were able to be evacuated. In total, we had 45 persons, including campers plus three DEEP staff who were at the campground, and they were safely transported through to the onshore safely through a boat rescue. The American Red Cross provided support. I want to especially thank the fire departments from Kent, Sherman, Southbury, Gaylordsville, and Middlesex, and Litchfield County coordinators who helped us, as well as our DEEP/ENCON police to conduct the boat rescue. All of the campers, our understanding, are local Connecticut residents. Kettletown State Park is closed, will be closed for the season. We know that because of the bridge being washed out, there are about 20 vehicles that remain at the campground. So we're working with National Guard on our near-term actions we can take to help recover those vehicles. But then we'll be assessing the damage to the bridge and providing updates going forward in terms of the future when that park plans for restoring the bridge for that park for next year. We have also Indian Well State Park is closed today as we're assessing damage and also safety at the water quality safety at the beach. And there was also an impact to Larkin Bridle Trail, which is about a 10-mile trail that it was impacted by a washout. From a dam safety standpoint, DEEP staff have been continually engaged in coordinating with emergency responders and dam owners across the municipal, federal, municipally owned dam, private owned dams, and our federal partners. With respect to the Stevenson Dam, that is owned by First Light and is a hydroelectric dam on Lake Zor. The dam is structurally sound and it's operating as designed. It's not a flood control dam, it's a hydroelectric dam. So the flows through the river have been passing through the dam at higher as designed. There were some conflicting reports yesterday that were circulating about the status of the dam, so I'll refer to the press release that First Light put out yesterday evening, just confirming the dam is structurally sound and is operating as planned. And I believe First Light has been providing some notifications today to households related to their flood management plan, just with respect to declining water levels that we're seeing in the area. In addition, we know that there's some impacts potentially around the Kingstown Dam and the adjacent Cope Pond Dam. We're working with FERC, which has the jurisdictional responsibility there. They're conducting an inspection. The issue that we're focused on there is any impacts to the structural integrity of the berm that supports the railroad line that is adjacent to that dam. So we'll be getting more data, and we can provide more updates as the day goes on. We have also, of course, through our dam safety program, we're monitoring the status and doing inspections and coordinating with owners of municipal dams and other private dams across the state that are high hazard dams or class B significant hazard dams. We have a dam watch program that tracks any dams that are experiencing 25-year levels and above. And then we're coordinating. We have two crews working from DIP today out doing inspections. We're also coordinating with private and municipal entities that are doing inspections of their dams. At this time, we don't see any imminent risk to any other dams that we've been monitoring. We will be working from to provide for emergency permitting authorizations for any maintenance that's needed across any dams that may have been impacted. In addition, we are seeing reports of debris in water, for example, oil tanks and so on and so forth, for example, that have been, we're surveying by drone at Lake Zor, and we're also in touch with municipalities and others who may be seeing debris impacting marinas and so on downstream. We have our drone system working from our emergency response unit and in coordination with EPA Region 1. To assess any hazardous debris that may be in the water. We urge anyone, if you see anything or have questions or need response, to contact DEEP Dispatch at 860-424-3333. From a wastewater standpoint, we've been in touch with all of the wastewater treatment plants in the area. We're not seeing any damage to facilities. The operational impacts are consistent with what we would see during a high rainfall event, and we're providing any info with respect to sewer overflows through our normal reporting channels on Twitter. We are going to be working very closely with our colleagues at the Department of Transportation to provide for any emergency permitting authorizations needed so that they can expedite their work. And finally, I'll just note that of course, this is a very historic and unprecedented rainfall event, and it's consistent with the accelerating impacts of climate change as we're experiencing. We have a strong track record here in the state through the Deep Climate Resilience Plan of a program of providing support to municipalities to help them plan for the types of infrastructure investments they need to better protect communities from, as best we can, from the impacts of these more extreme weather events. All told, over the last 3 years, Connecticut municipalities have received over $108 million of federal funding, FEMA brief funding. I really appreciate the Blumenthal's presence here and the support from our federal delegation, who have really helped us receive more a robust share of federal funding that's available for these types of forward-looking infrastructure projects. We provided $8 million last year through the Deep Climate Resilience Fund to provide planning grants for municipalities to help design and conceive of the projects that they can apply to the federal government for. And that included about $700,000 in an award to Waterbury, and then another roughly $700,000 to the Naugatuck Valley COG to support a plan for stormwater management projects that can help support this region. And next month, in September, we will be opening up the next round of the Deep Climate Resilience Fund. We have $75 million in bond authorizations that are provided by the legislature, and we'll be putting that out for proposals from municipalities to support additional planning grants so that they can conceive of projects, but also for the first time providing match funds because the FEMA program requires state or local match. So we'll be inviting municipalities to apply for those match funds so that they can pursue the next round of FEMA funding that will be opening up, we understand, in September. Sorry for that. There's a lot going on at DEEP. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Commissioner Dykes. Before we move into our legislative partners, can we hear from First Selectman George Tucker?
Thank you. Thank you all for coming today. This is a tragic and devastating day for Oxford. We have this morning recovered two bodies
Sure, we will seek federal aid there in time. entitled to what these communities have suffered and otherwise irreparable cost and damage. And there are programs available. The Federal Disaster Declaration, which the governor, I'm told, is seeking, we've talked. We will provide every ounce of effort as a federal delegation, spare no energy or effort in seeking federal help from FEMA and other agencies that have an obligation, a responsibility to provide it, just as they aid Oklahoma in tornadoes or Florida in hurricanes. These flash floods here are equally destructive, not only to life and well-being, but also to property. But we need to address this issue as a longer-term challenge. Resilience against climate change is not just for the coastline. Flash floods and other disasters affect all of Connecticut. We all have a stake in planning and preparing. And that's why the federal government is providing those $50 or more billion for the nation as a whole, and hundreds of millions, and I hope eventually billions of dollars for Connecticut, to prepare, plan, and prevent the kind of damage that we saw here, the destruction that can wreck lives and businesses and tear apart communities. In the meantime, we will be working for resilience programs that invest in stronger infrastructure so that the Little River is contained when it threatens to overflow and do this kind of damage. There's no mystery here as to what is required to prevent these kinds of destructive disasters in the future. It is investment in the physical stuff that contains and constrains these natural disasters. I hope that folks see the great work that our agencies are going to be doing out there. When you see those cones, slow down, move over. It applies to the big highways, but also to 67 and 34 and 188, which are going to require a lot of work. You'll see those cones out there for a while. Slow down, move over. The guys working out there are doing a job under difficult circumstances. And the state police who are out there are also doing their job. So I know that the towns have already started the recovery work, and we have begun drafting the papers that are necessary for us to support a disaster declaration. It will be targeted at the communities that have suffered losses, and it will be in partnership with the state and Governor Lamont, whom I'm pleased to introduce now.
We could hear from our local representative, state representative. I'll start with Representative Labriola.
As the local state representative here in Oxford, we're just right around the corner, I can tell you that the people of Oxford, we're hurting, and our hearts are breaking. So we need a lot of help, and we're just really moved by the response of the governor, our senator, the federal and state authorities, our agencies, our commissioners who are here, and their staff, and we're just so pleased and thankful for all the good work that they've already begun, because we need it. We need it now, and we're going to need it for the next few weeks and months ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for being here. I also offer my condolences to the two Oxford residents who were tragically lost as a result of this historic flooding. Some people have called this a thousand-year storm. I'll remind those of you that are old enough to remember that 69 years ago yesterday was the flood, the great flood of Waterbury, which put the downtown Waterbury and all of these valley towns underwater. I'm thrilled to see that we have our federal members of our federal delegation in Washington here. We have our governor here who interrupted his plans to be here in Oxford. I had a conversation with the governor. We have an agreement, if you will, that the state will provide through its agencies all of the resources we need to get Oxford back on its feet. Oxford got sucker punched yesterday and then taken out at the knees. Our infrastructure is broken. Our main highway that runs through this town is broken. We have a loss of life. We have a loss of businesses. We have people that have had significant damage to their homes. And we need the full strength of the local government and the state government and the federal government to fix this beautiful town and get it back running in the right direction again. But thank you for being here. Thank you, Governor, for making this priority today as well. Thank you.
State Senator Tony Wong, I represent Newtown and Bethel. I want to thank the governor for interrupting his vacation to be here. It is important to have the leadership show. It does matter. My heart goes out to the people of Oxford and the loss of life, but this was a region that got hit in a devastating sheer force and a show of Mother Nature's power. When we talk about the rainfall, I just checked. The average rainfall for Oxford and Newtown for the month of August is about 3.5 inches. We got over a range of 12 to 16 inches of rainfall this past weekend. It is a catastrophic amount of rain. No infrastructure could accommodate it. That being said, what I saw today in going out with law enforcement and first responders and getting firsthand view of the devastation is, it is not just what you see in the pictures. It is the infrastructure damage that we don't see. I sit on the transportation committee. I want to echo Commissioner Yucalito's reiteration that if there are blocks and if there are detours, respect it. Do not be sightseeing to get that photo or get that video because the structure is unsound. It is truly, first and foremost, a public safety concern. I think the second point is the fact that we are going to need collaboration from all sectors of state, local, and federal. I'm so grateful, and I'm going to repeat again, I'm grateful that the governor has made the effort to show his commitment to the residents that I represent. But I think the second point is also for us. I know I speak for Senator Fowle, Senator Kelly, and Senator Hardin will speak afterwards, is we have reached out and asked for the federal government to declare this region a disaster area so we then can get the federal funds that are necessary for restoration of infrastructure and also be able to salvage and support those families and lives that have been disrupted. This is what we do as legislators. We are here to advocate for our community. It can't be done without the agencies and the first responders and the people that make the entire system work. So I'm happy to be a part of it. Thank you for having me here, Mr. Temple. And I think it's important. Every one of our towns need to work together and help the people that need. They need it now. Thank you.
I just want to echo Senator Wong and mention this is a regional issue. Obviously, it seems like Oxford unfortunately got hit the worst, but the eastern end of my Senate district got hit pretty hard as well. And I appreciate the governor, I appreciate all the state agencies and the federal delegation for taking this with this serious nature they should be and doing what we need to do to build back from this because a lot of this state, a big broad swath of Western Connecticut is going to have a lot to build back from, unfortunately. And with the help of state government and federal government, hopefully we can, and local government as well, we can work to build back for our constituents and our businesses. So thank you.
Yeah, so here we are again. And as Eric said, yesterday, ironically, was the 69th anniversary of terrible flooding right here that devastated our towns. The Little River became a big river. And it is happening with more and more frequency. Just a year ago, a lot of us were there in the Connecticut River Valley, and they had been irrigating it due to severe drought. And there they were 2 weeks later, and the fields are all underwater. And It's just a reminder that we have to hang together at a time like this, especially given the tragedy. George, right here in your town in particular, those two women swept away. It's just incredible what happened there. And it reminds you a little bit of how we work together. And starting here, George, and you working with your fellow first selectmen, mayors, the public works department, the first responders, the first ones there. I love the regional assistance. I love the other towns coming in and providing what additional support they can as well. You know, Brenda was there. We were on with the Emergency Operations Center, almost immediately. And I'll tell you, how that works. That works with Garrett Ucolino and his team from DOT, Department of Transportation. They have to go out there. They have to check the roads. They have to check the bridges for safety. Make sure going forward, as you heard from George and otherwise, when you see those yellow cones, stop. You may say, oh my gosh, look at that road. It looks like it's okay to me. I don't see much water. There can be a culvert under there. Water can be going under that. Thing can go anytime. Please pay special attention there. Katie and our group at Deep, they're taking a special look right now, checking all the different dams. Make sure those dams are holding. Right now, as you heard from Katie, those dams are holding. We've got them reinforced. Reinforced a lot since 1955 and able to keep us safe. We were there, Brenda, with a public health. Why is public health there? Well, they got to pay special attention to our nursing homes, special attention to our hospitals, those most at need, most vulnerable. We're there, obviously, with Eversource and UI. Make sure the electricity is on. Where do we have the most needs? Make sure that we can respond accordingly. And I'm really proud that we've been able to work very closely with the legislative delegation you have here fighting every day for this community in this region. And I got to say the same thing for our federal delegation. Senator Blumenthal is here. We are filing for emergency declaration to make sure we get to the front of the line, make sure that front of the line means we get every resource we can to make sure that Oxford and neighboring towns can get back on their feet. It also, as Garrett tells me, accelerates the permitting process. So if we have to do any special repairs to, say, those bridges or dams, we can get to the front of the line there as well. And we are trying to think down the road in terms of resilience, what we can do to make sure this is a lot less likely to happen again. We have plenty of time to discuss that. But right here now, I just want to thank the people standing behind me. Thank those first responders. Our hearts goes out to those that lost their lives. We're doing everything we can to make sure. I can't tell you this will never happen again. I can tell you we're going to make sure we make it less frequent and make sure it's less severe. And that's something we're working on every day. Thanks, everybody.
Hey, Governor, was enough time to alert people in advance? I'd like to ask George that, too.
If you don't mind, a couple of things I forgot. You may not know about our town. Let me tell you about our town. Since we had this problem, I can't tell you how many private citizens called and requested that they help out in any way that we can. Well, of course, right now is not the time to do it, but that's Oxford. That's the way they are. And there are a few people here when you all leave, we're going to have to do the very difficult work of getting back to normal. One individual, Arnie Jensen, is also on the Board of Selectmen. We'll be working together along with Dave McCain. And I want to thank my administrative assistant, Kristen Rosa. She did a great job doing this. And, of course, Scott Pelletier, who is our emergency services coordinator. He did a wonderful job. And Jim Oliver, who has to put together the bills and hopefully we can get it paid.
Is there any more
in the
situation for them? Were they in a car with
no
information on how?
Yes, it appears that they were both in a car. Is that correct?
I just want to tell you how we're going to tell the people.
I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to tell the people. I'm going to t
things that were swept away by the rising water. One of them was earlier in the afternoon. Firefighters were on scene attempting to get the victim from the vehicle. When a rash of water came in, the vehicle shifted, the firefighter fell down, the victim fell down, got swept down the river. A second firefighter trying to attempt that rescue went down. The old firefighters removed them from the water and got them to safety. One of them was treated for minor injuries and is okay today. The second victim was in a vehicle, climbed out, and tried crossing the water, made it to a sign, and was hanging on to the sign. Firefighters were in there with a high wheel vehicle trying to get to her, and the racing water was too much for her, and she got swept away.
So these three people were not together.
Two separate incidents, two female victims. The health department has been out, going to be checking the area deeps in the area on scene because most of the homes that have been flooded have oil tanks in them. We've had dozens of propane cylinders floating down the river leaking. We've been trying to retrieve them and secure them as best we can. We currently completed the recovery of the two victims today, early this morning, and a little while ago. So that has been taken care of. The state police are taking care of the investigation and notifying everybody on that. And we'll continue to monitor the situation and assist any residents in any way they can.
Just to be clear, are there any other ongoing rescues or search for people that may be trapped in their homes at this time?
No, we checked everybody that's called in. We've been to everybody that called, checked. Everybody is safe at this time. We have no additional requests for rescue.
George, is there enough time for the advance of this? How do you think about that?
Well, I don't think there was enough advance notice. We get every year we get probably 30 of these flash flood warnings. And as a result, most people ignore them. And, you know, this didn't seem like any different than any others. As soon as I was aware that it was going to be a problem, we went out and fought it. The firemen were out there. So, it just came upon us like lightning. You know, as you said, six inches an hour. That's, that's not expected here.
We also saw some houses near links around the dam. And a lot of homes that have been damaged, and I think you mentioned early on the insurance. Really, people don't necessarily have flooding insurance.
Yeah, I mean, that could be a problem. But there was damage to homes. I know of one where the foundation collapsed, and they had to go to the to stay in a hotel. So, you know, unfortunately, there was that. On the issue of safety and water, I got a text from George Logan from Aquarian, and there was damage to their equipment. However, it has no impact on the quality of the water, and they will continue to provide water as needed. So, I wanted to get that straight.
This one home was evacuated. How many evacuations did
you have? That's hard to say because a lot of people were evacuated by their neighbors. The evacuation at Jackson Cove was the one I was most concerned with because it involved kids. And, they did a beautiful job on that, getting them out of there. But we had people in Flying Rock that were stranded, and Tom Haynes very graciously allowed these people to go into the apartments and the rec area there. So, that was fine. But, everybody's back. So.
the collaboration a little bit. Obviously, there were a lot of energy volunteering with this question for you, which is there were so many different agencies that came into Oxford to assist. Can you talk about that collaboration?
That's part of our standard mutual aid understanding agreement that we have with all our local partners and state partners. We had assistance from the Beacon Falls Fire Department because of the way the water was coming. We were cut off from getting to the south end of town, so they came in and were able to assist there. We had the Seminole Fire Department came in to assist with us on a rescue over on Route 34. We had to rescue an individual from his home. They used boats and got them out. We had the USAR team is the one that went and performed the rescue of the civilians at the Jackson's Cove, and that's one of our regional assets. Southway has been hit pretty hard with the water issues too. They had some regional assets there, and when we were running at the height, they were low. They sent some of those assets to us, and we were able to completely do everything we needed to do and get everybody safe. And we were able to shelter anybody that we evacuated from cars or buildings in our three fire stations. And as the selectman said, we were able to utilize Quarry Rock. We had 140 people that couldn't go anywhere. The roads were washed. You couldn't go. So Tom Haynes did shelter them in his apartments. The daycare that was there opened up, and we put families in there with the kids. And our Market 32 partners fed everybody, fed the firefighters, fed all the families, and it was a good collaborative effort between everybody. Our public works going side by side with us, getting roads open, Eversource, you know, getting power cut down so we can get into places. So it works as a collaborative effort. It's a lot of stuff that happens at once, and you know the volunteers they did a great job getting everything done and getting everybody safe. Unfortunately, as we did have two fatalities.
Just to clarify, is there? Are you guys under a state of emergency, or is there a disaster declaration commission we've been declaring?
I'm in Oxford. The first selectman declared a state of emergency at 6 p.m. yesterday.
Are you brought in for these first responders? Obviously, that's a very, your job is to respond, but that was a very upsetting situation.
We will handle a debriefing, and we will offer any assistance if anyone needs any assistance.
Lorraine is working out today. How concerned are you? Some concern in fact that Commissioner Nicolino laid out with debris, damage under the roadway, people can see. How worried are you about
that? I'm worried about that because people do not obey anything that we put up. They don't obey the signs. They do not obey, don't drive on roads with water on them. So that concerns us. But hopefully the amount of rain that's coming will come in a moderate pace, and the basins and the river should be able to handle that with help, hopefully no other major issues.
The timeline between disaster declaration and the federal money actually getting to this thing, I guess. What's the typical outlook? How fast people expect to take those federal dollars?
We have filed for the emergency declaration, and Garrett and the team right now that the weather has cleared a little bit, we're able to do a better assessment of the nature of the damage, be it to our public infrastructure, private homes, local police station here. So we'll be able to get a good bead on that file, I think, by, within a week or so. And, Ken's question about, did we do enough in terms of this warning? All I can say is I've been through a few of these. Weather predicting is not an exact science, but Brenda was saying in this case, I think the National Weather Service did a pretty good job. You never know whether it's going to be 6 inches over 3 hours or 6 inches every hour for 2.5 hours. And this was as severe a storm as we can remember. These rain bombs are sudden and they drop hard. And we got text messages out to all the people in these local communities. That doesn't work for everybody. You have a senior or somebody who's maybe not connecting that way, reach out to them and do what you can as well. But I think the response was pretty good. But you know what we do now? We debrief and see how we can do it better next time.
To Mike's question about the timing of the federal declaration, the way it works, as the governor described it, is the governor takes the first step, files for an emergency or disaster declaration, and then it is reviewed by FEMA. And we got to present evidence. We can't just say, give us the money. And we have begun documenting. I did this morning, taking photographs in Seymour, that kind of devastation. is similar to what happened when Connecticut was struck by the microburst. You may remember Brookfield, Hamden, the Danbury area, where the disaster, in effect, was targeted. You could drive down a street, and one side of the street was devastated, the other was untouched. But we got the kind of help that we needed. I would say it is probably a matter of weeks, I hope not months. We're going to push very hard. I met with business people this morning who are shut down. As Susan asked, what happens to those businesses? They are closed. They are unenterable by order of the local health authorities because they are a real and present danger. There are propane lines that have to be secured. There are other kinds of utility and power lines that have been severed. The ramifications here are not just what you see. They are literally underground everywhere all the time. And that's why the federal declaration has to be pursued as soon as possible. And I think the state has always done a really good job of documenting, collecting evidence. And I can tell you our delegation is going to be laser focused. We're going to be on this quest full time right away.
FEMA has said that it's already run out of disaster relief funding for this year, second year in a row. So where is this money
coming from? The nature of emergency relief and disaster aid is you find it. They have found it for other communities and states. They're going to find it for Connecticut. That will have to be determined, but there are specific criteria. It isn't necessarily the cosmetic repairs, more structural, and it can be part of what the municipality requests. So we're going to be as broad as we can possibly be in collecting damage relief for businesses and homes, as well as municipalities, even though it is more difficult to cover those kinds of costs.
There you have it, word for word from officials today in Oxford, Connecticut. This is a photo yesterday of Little River in Oxford, which flooded streets, businesses, and even this bar. Mike Lindberg shared some really amazing, incredible live videos. So the link is in my story. You're welcome to click on that. To give you more accurate archival history, especially if you're driving or listening to this in podcast or podcast form, I'm going to read you the rest of my article. So, the flooding, causes of the flooding. The flooding driven by unprecedented rainfall and exacerbated by aging infrastructure overwhelmed rivers and drainage systems across the state. Scientists point to the increasing frequency of extreme weather events as a consequence of climate change, making it clear that Connecticut's infrastructure needs to be more resilient than ever. Despite this, the state's ability to cope with such disasters have proven disastrously inadequate. Connecticut earned a D+ grade for roads, according to the 2022 Connecticut Infrastructure Report Card. There's a hyperlink there so you can view that in more detail. Now, last night, the National Weather Service said, quote, flooding of rivers, creeks, streams, and other low-lying and flood-prone locations is occurring after receiving 5 to 10 inches of rain. Several structures are flooded. Numerous roads remain closed due to flooding. The Still River, Housatonic River, and Pomperaug River remain in flood stage. At 11:37 p.m. Eastern Time, Emergency Management is continuing to report ongoing water issues, water rescues, several mudslides, numerous washed out roadways and bridges, as well as swollen rivers taking place from central Fairfield County into northern New Haven County. In addition, emergency management officials are assessing the integrity of several dams in the area, unquote. Government failures. At the heart of this issue is a failure of governance. Connecticut residents are now questioning why the state was so unprepared for this heavy rainfall, despite receiving significant federal funding for infrastructure improvements. In 2021, President Joe Biden, along with Vice President Kamala Harris, announced a major infusion of funds aimed at shoring up critical infrastructure across the country. Connecticut was among the states that benefited from this initiative, with Governor Ned Lamont's administration receiving substantial sums specifically designed for improving flood control measures and updating outdated systems. Please follow those links for more details from the White House and other sources. However, in the wake of the flooding, it's evident that these funds were either mismanaged or, worse, never reached their intended projects. Communities that were promised protection from events like these are instead grappling with the devastating reality of government failure. Governor Lamont's response. Amid the unfolding disaster yesterday, Governor Ned Lamont issued a statement addressing the severe flooding and the state's ongoing response efforts. He highlighted the immediate actions taken by the state's emergency management team, including coordination with local officials and the deployment of urban search and rescue teams, who he says have helped at least 100 people evacuate unsafe conditions. Lamont described the storm as quote unquote historic and emphasized the need for residents, particularly in the western portion of Connecticut, to stay home until the flooding recedes. He urged people not to attempt to drive through flooded roads and directed them to ctroads.org for real-time updates on road closures. The governor also reminded residents to call 911 for emergencies and 211 for non-emergency assistance. Then there was the statement from First Light Energy on the Stevenson Dam. Just a side note, I drove over the Stevenson Dam quite a lot when I lived in Connecticut. It's absolutely a beautiful, historic dam, but there's many challenges to navigate it on a good, sunny, clear day, let alone on a rainy day. And it's an incredibly popular destination for motorcyclists. Amid the extreme rainfall and subsequent flooding, First Light Energy, who owns the Stevenson Dam, stated that the dam, located in the lower Housatonic River area, and I have to adjust that sentence, that didn't make sense to me as I read it, apologies. The company assured the community that the dam is structurally secure and operating as designed, emphasizing that it is not in danger of failing. However, First Light reiterated that the Stevenson Dam is not a flood control facility and cannot hold back water, meaning that whatever flows down the river must be passed through the dam at the same rate. First Light urged residents to obey the instructions of emergency service personnel and avoid approaching the dam and the Housatonic River until the dangerously high flows subside. The company highlighted the risks associated with high-level waters and elevated flow rates, which are particularly hazardous in low-lying areas of lower Housatonic communities. The company also emphasized its proactive measures, including constant monitoring of USGS gauges, that's the United States Geological Survey, and communication with National Weather Service River Forecast Center. First Light operates its Housatonic River hydroelectric facilities under strict protocols approved by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers as required by its Federal Energy Regulatory Commission FERC license. To aid the lower Housatonic community in responding to potential flooding, First Light has implemented a flood notification system, providing emergency alerts when flows exceed a certain threshold. The system is crucial for helping residents anticipate and prepare for high flows that could lead to flooding. You have to be, just another side note, you have to be really on top of those alerts, because in my experience, I don't know offhand for that system, but in my experience, those alerts come very, very quickly. And let's say if you're out and not at home and need to move a car up to a higher ground, for example, as some of my family did in another part of the state, then that timing can really affect things. Some more commentary from me, my cops in Congress commentary, corruption suspicions. In a state often derided as Corrupticut, suspicions of corruption are now swirling around Governor Lamont's administration. Where did the critical infrastructure funds go? Why were essential flood mitigation projects not completed or even started in some areas? The lack of transparency and accountability has fueled widespread speculation that the funds may have been siphoned off or misallocated, leaving Connecticut's vulnerable infrastructure to crumble under pressure. You can follow that link for more information. I did a screenshot share video of one of these supposed transparency portals, and it was locked to only login users under a CTDOT website that was very cumbersome and complicated to navigate, and it would not let me or create an account to access it, meaning there's a lack of transparency. Where is Senator Chris Murphy, the junior Democrat in all of this? He was not at today's press conference, was he? No, he wasn't. What has he done, or more specifically, not done? He had up until as at press time, he had been completely silent on social media as of press time, zero mention of the disastrous flooding and the thousands of people it affected. I think it's hundreds of thousands at this point after listening to the press conference, if not potentially millions. Murphy faces Republican challenger Matt Corey this fall, a rematch of 2018. Again, he was not at the press conference, and today is the first day of the Democratic National Committee convention. So I imagine he's there instead of being in Connecticut. As questions emerge about the chaotic handling of the flood response and infrastructure funds, residents are left to pick up the pieces of their shattered lives. As you heard from officials, many lack flood insurance. The Lamont administration has been slow to respond for calls for transparency, further eroding public trust. Again, just a side note, and to archive this in a meaningful way in one place, I find it very interesting that Senator Chris Murphy was not there. I will reiterate that again. I think I'm saying this for a third time, because that's a historic move and response in an election year when you're trying to get reelected, number one. Also, meteorologists on X, formerly Twitter, stated that the forecasting for the storm was off, to put it nicely. It wasn't up to par, and there's been multiple meteorologists who have said that, but one specifically told me that it was, although it had been somewhat on radar as it happened the day before, there were no indications. And further complicating matters, it was over a weekend, so that particular meteorologist was away for the weekend and was not paying close attention to the storm, he told me. So I find that very interesting, given the fact that Governor Ned Lamont, in the press conference, stated that the forecasters knew the flooding was coming, when in fact, they didn't. I don't know why he's lying, but that's the facts. So, where do we go from here? The path forward for Connecticut is fraught with challenges. Rebuilding will require more than just repairing the physical damage. It will necessitate restoring faith in government and ensuring future infrastructure projects are completed with integrity and transparency. There is also a pressing need for independent oversight of how federal funds are used, especially in a state with a notorious reputation for corruption. Governor Lamont's administration must confront these failures head-on, addressing the gaps in infrastructure that have left communities exposed and vulnerable. Moving forward, Connecticut must prioritize resilience against extreme weather, ensuring the federal funds are spent wisely and that the state is better prepared for the next inevitable disaster. The question remains, Will Connecticut's leaders rise to the occasion and protect their citizens, or will the state continue to be haunted by the specter of corruption and mismanagement? Will Connecticut voters realize that Democrats have left them in the dark, often literally? The answer may be seen this fall after the election. Voters will determine whether Connecticut can truly weather future storms. Finally, of note, what does the Norwalk River in Connecticut have in common with Lake Lure, North Carolina? Schnabel Engineering is working on both dams. I find that interesting in my research. So again, I'm putting this all together, therefore it's exclusive details. So just some situational awareness, an exclusive or scoop is an important news story that is first reported by a journalist. This goes beyond breaking news when no other journalists are known to be reporting on an important issue. To my knowledge, no other journalists are reporting on the suspected corruption and the questions that swirl in the wake of this historic flooding. This article, again, is free to read due to generous support from founding member subscribers and free to listen to on my YouTube channel and on Facebook. Thank you. Please support my future work. And in case you missed it, there are 6 reasons to support my independent journalism that you can dive more deeply into. Of course, all those mentioned are presumed innocent until proven guilty. To be clear, no one mentioned today has been charged with a crime that I know of. Learn more about my newsletter and my background. You can click on that link to learn more. Follow me on X, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. Send constructive criticism, fan mail, and tips with public documents for future stories, copsandcongress@gmail.com. Interested in sponsoring a future issue of Cops in Congress? Email me with your ideas and budget. And finally, upgrade to paid to leave a comment and don't miss out on exclusive content. Thank you for reading and listening to Cops in Congress by Annie Dance. This is public, so please feel free to share it. I greatly appreciate your support. Thanks for listening. See you next time.